not sorry, Reese's.
COVID-19 vaccines are bringing hope and questions. This is why we're bringing understanding to the challenge of vaccinating America. Weeknights on the CBS Evening News with Nora O'Donnell.
Closed captioning for News 12 is brought to you by Kenneth Nugent. From the station that's on your side, this is News 12, First at 5.
First at 5. For years, South Carolina lawmakers have been working to improve the foster and adoption process across the state. Now lawmakers are getting feedback and addressing some of those concerns.
And we are live at First at 5 from downtown Augusta, where the final touches are wrapping up for Arts in the Heart. We have more on the traffic impacts and what you can expect from the fan favorite event. But first, three EMS responders recovering tonight after possibly being exposed to fentanyl after responding to an incident.
Reports say it happened around 10 this morning in McDuffie County. It all starts with a 911 call for help about a medical emergency in Heritage Villas. When they got there, EMS went in the home and found two Thompson men inside. They started providing that medical treatment right there on the scene. And while doing that, the three who had been in contact with one of those men started displaying symptoms associated with possible fentanyl exposure.
Fentanyl is so dangerous. One of the men who was being treated died. The other is still recovering. GBI agents, they have taken over the investigation to see if, in fact, fentanyl was in the home, and an autopsy for the victim will happen. Of course, we will keep you updated as we learn more about this story.
Much more news ahead, but right now, a check of the weather these nights, just about 10 minutes. Robbie, thanks very much. We have an update right now from Lake Hartwell, where divers and recovery crews have been out on the lake all day today. They're trying to raise that plane and the dead pilot trapped 120 feet down underwater after that plane crashed last week. Earlier today, divers exhausted those air supplies. They were forced back to the surface to take a break. They resumed about an hour later, but no sign of the boat or the pilot yet.
Two suspects are in jail after being accused of using a drone to smuggle illegal items into a Davisboro prison. Sunday, deputies found two people parked in a vehicle at a church on Highway 231. While talking with them, they noticed a drone hovering in the air with a large object. 34-year-old Courtney Nickerson is charged with attempt to commit a felony, possession of a firearm during the commission of a crime, and possession of a firearm by a first offender felon. 26-year-old Lacey Rogers is charged with criminal attempt to commit a felony and possession of a firearm during the commission of a felony. New First at 5, Governor Henry McMaster and the South Carolina Department of Corrections have filed an appeal. A judge ruled a firing squad and electrocutions unconstitutional.
Four inmates sued the state after state lawmakers passed a new law setting the electric chair as the default method of execution in 2021. South Carolina has not been able to carry out an execution by lethal injection since its supply of that necessary drug expired in 2013. The state has not been able to get any more drugs because pharmaceutical manufacturers have not been willing to supply them. Earlier this week, a state senator announcing plans to introduce a shield law that would keep those companies' names from becoming public. Without either a shield law passed or that court ruling overturned, South Carolina is not able to carry out an execution. Hours before railway workers were set to go on strike, the Biden administration announcing a tentative agreement in the railway labor dispute. The president calls it a win for thousands of rail workers, as well as the companies who will now be able to, quote, retain and recruit more workers. The agreement came around 5 this morning after about 20 consecutive hours of negotiations at the Department of Labor. The deal will now go back to those unions for them to take a vote. A group focusing on improving the lives of South Carolina's children traveling around the state soon to find out how they can get that done.
And they want to hear directly from South Carolinians. Our State House reporter Mary Green has the details on how you can weigh in.
Every year, the Joint Citizens and Legislative Committee on Children, also known as the Children's Committee, embarks on a listening tour around South Carolina. It's made up of state agency leaders, citizens, and lawmakers who have the power to enact change right here at the State House.
It's an opportunity for you to express concerns that you may have that are really relevant to what this committee is charged with doing. And, you know, it might be an issue that we're not even aware of.
Legislation to improve South Carolina's adoption and fostering processes, put more regulations around vaping, and offer paid family leave to state employees have all come out of the Children's Committee in recent years. Tuesday to hold a hearing in Florence, then in Charleston on Thursday, and in Greenville the next week, before wrapping up with two meetings in Columbia in October. The leaders of state agencies are also committee members, including the Departments of Mental Health, Social Services, Juvenile Justice, and Education. Lawmakers say these hearings are an opportunity for any South Carolinian to bring concerns directly to the people who have the ability to make changes and improvements.
You don't have to be a doctor or a lawyer. Everyday citizens come and talk to us about these things, and this is what's really good about it.
People who want to speak for up to 5 minutes at one of those hearings can sign up by emailing the address on your screen. They can also submit written testimony to that email. And the last day to email in written testimony is October 14th. Reporting from the State House, I'm Mary Green.
Every city's hearing will go from 5 p.m. until 7 that night.
There will also be a morning hearing in Columbia.
We have a traffic alert for you. Just one day left until Arts in the Heart returns to downtown Augusta. And you can see there as we take a live look downtown, set up here is well underway. Some of those country names starting to appear on those banners. That good food will be cooking before you know it. That's always a big highlight there. The food, the music, the fun, great arts and crafts as well. It's all set up. It's underway along Broad Street. And there are some closings to talk about as well.
Yeah, oh gosh. The food is my favorite part, though. Something. I'm very distracted by this going on. This actually is among the biggest events for downtown Augusta, attracting and almost 95,000 people, and the city estimates more than $3.5 million in economic impact. That's big bucks, according to Destination Augusta, our local tourism bureau.
Looks great down there. It's going to be fun. A few streets downtown, of course, as always, will be closed because of this. Right now, McCartan from Broad to Jones and then 9th Street closed, as well as the parking well there in the middle of the street around the 600 block of Broad Street. Then tomorrow, one eastbound lane of Reynolds Street will close down between 9th and 8th Street right there near the Common, and they'll stay closed until the end of the festival Sunday evening. Should be great weather for that. And tomorrow, the 29th annual Border Bash at SRP Park. Riley was just saying, set up and started over there. Every year, the Bulldogs and the Gamecocks, they come together for some fun before the big game, pregame festivities. And thanks, as always, to Andy Hunter. He gave some great drone video last year that he shot for us. Laura and Alyssa are going to have live coverage from SRP Park all evening tomorrow. And Border Bash tomorrow from 4 until 8 in the evening. It's a big time, big weekend in downtown Augusta.
Big party. CSRE College Night is back. High school students get to meet recruiters from more than 90 colleges and universities. But this is the big deal here. They've got the chance to earn almost $10,000 in scholarships. It is happening right now at the James Brown Arena. Admission is free. It runs from, well, it started at 5, and then it ends tonight at 8:30, so you've still got a good amount of time to get down there. It just opened. In less than 30 minutes, our Nick Veland will be live with more on the opportunities students can expect. And parents, we know you are busy taking notes.
Sure.
This is a very valuable experience.
It keeps you from driving all over the Southeast looking at colleges. They're all right here in Augusta.
Yes.
Tonight.
It is one of the biggest expenses for young families, but tonight a new push to drop prices on costly diapers. Oh, I remember when my daughter got out of them. It was a huge raise.
Yeah, big raise for families.
Yes.
And we are expecting a few lucky spots to briefly get into the 50s again tomorrow morning, but it is going to be on the incline for temperatures into the weekend. Update there just after break.
You are in trouble. No one out beats the hut.
Parents already know diapers are expensive, overly expensive. A growing number of states are actually eliminating the sales tax on diapers.
But now some Georgia organizations are asking our lawmakers to drop the sales tax as well, just to help some families who need it the most. Rachel Aragon has more.
For many families with young children,
you need diapers. It's not something that you can decide not to purchase.
That purchase, according to Helping Mama's founder, Jamie Lackey, is putting a strain on families across the state.
And the cost is so exorbitant. Families are literally choosing right now between paying their rent, utilities, food, gas to get to work, and a box of diapers for their children.
It's one of the baby supply banks, and they're working with banks in Athens and Savannah to reach out to state lawmakers, trying to convince them to craft a bill that would eliminate the sales tax on diapers.
We'd love to make contact and figure out who would like to champion this for us? Who would like to help us see this, make this better for Georgia families?
Florida, New York, Maryland, and Louisiana Just a handful of states to recently pass or sign legislation that would pause or eliminate sales tax on diapers.
Inflation is hitting everyone.
It's a tax some parents of little ones would like to see dropped.
I feel like having a kid more so now in these times is just more expensive than it used to, so always looking for sales and, you know, where to cut costs, things like that.
According to National Diaper Bank Network, eliminating a 7% sales tax on diapers would save a family around $66 annually.
I think any relief you can give families right now is huge.
Lackey says her nonprofit is splitting time between distributing donations to families in need and reminding those inside the state capitol there's a desperate need for some relief.
There are so many issues and so many needy, worthy causes that need attention, and it's just fighting for that spotlight, for that voice, for these families to give them that relief.
Our sister station in Atlanta did reach out to Governor Kemp's office to see if he would look into killing this tax. So far, he has not responded.
It's an expensive time in your life. My mom used to say, this too shall pass,
yes.
And it felt like it never would.
Yes, yes. But when you're out of that phase, you really do get a raise.
It does feel like that.
Yeah, too bad other things take the place of diapers and other more expensive things.
Exactly. Well, the sales tax would help. We'll see what the governor decides to do. Let's head outside now for a live look at our... Riley, thanks a lot. Still to come, first at 5, we meet Eric in this week's Grant Me Hope.
Attorney John Foy and Associate. Grant Me Hope. Finding every foster child their forever home.
And today we want to introduce you to Eric. He loves sports and he needs a loving home.
This is part of our Grant Me Hope partnership, where we try to find homes for older children in the foster care system. Meet Eric.
Hey, I'm Eric and I'm 16. I love cats and reptiles more. I like snakes. Snakes are pretty cool, but you gotta watch out for what kind you have. Cats, they're pretty nice and cuddly. I had a cat, his name was Shadow. He was big and he was really fat. He was like a pillow. I came from New York. I got here when it was pretty cold. I adapted fast, but I really don't like the heat that much around here. I moved a lot, so I'm used to seeing new things, meeting new people. I used to play football and basketball. We go to the gym a lot. We used to play basketball. We got a workout center. We got a pool table. We got a lot of stuff in our gym. Just practice and just shoot hoops. It helps your brain focus and helps you calm down. I like engines, like electronics. I can build stuff pretty good. I built a robot not that long ago. I'm going to be an engineer. I'm going to work on cars. I'm going to ask my uncle. He's an engineer too. I'm going to ask him to train me and see if he can help me out with that gig. When he was young, he used to take cars apart and put them back together. He learned the hard way. Instead of like going to school and stuff, you can have a mentor help you step by step, teach you what to do, tell you what's wrong, what's right. It helps you out way better. First comes to me is it has to have TVs, a video game, it has to have animals, what else? You gotta have a lot of food. I would pick a mechanic father and a nurse for a mom. My name is Eric and I'm looking for a forever home.
Grant Me Hope, because every child deserves a loving home.
And we hope Eric finds the perfect place. To learn more about Eric or any of the kids featured here, go to our website, wrdw.com, then search Grant Me Hope.
Well, we are back with our latest winner for our Plunkett Heat and Air Sunshade giveaway. A big congratulations to Miss Phyllis Pollard from Augusta, Georgia. To get your own sunshade, just go to wrdw.com. You can click on contests and enter your email right there. I'll have another look at the forecast for you coming up after the break.
Take a look at this. Have you ever seen an ornamental pepper tree? The fruit comes in shades of red and purple, yellow and orange, even black and white. This, of course, is from Riley's Facebook page. His dad planted these seeds, and look at it now.
I know. So he posted this, and I was scrolling through Facebook, and his dad calls them Christmas tree things because they look like Christmas tree lights.
Yep.
I could not get over it that they look like Christmas tree lights.
I honestly, he had been sending me pictures of this plant, and I'm like, oh, cool, pepper plant, no big deal. But now that they actually have the peppers on them, I realize why he was so proud of it. So, I mean, that is really cool. I've never seen a pepper plant like that.
They look fake.
I thought they were Christmas lights on them, but he said he just threw some seeds in the ground outside the shop. And,
wow.
3 months later, there you go.
That's my kind of low maintenance.
You know what's funny, though? I was in Lidl last weekend, and they had ornamental peppers, like, up at the front.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They're
so
pretty popular.
Now we know what they are. And we were just reading over the break about them. They actually change colors as they grow. So they'll turn different shades of red and yellow. And like, we're learning all about ornamental peppers right now.
Solar powered, no bulbs required there.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, with our winters, we've had previously, we may still have some peppers on the plant around that time frame. Hey, beautiful weather out there for the rest of this evening. If you have plans for the weekend, remember, we are expecting those temperatures in the upper 80s.
And there is much more news ahead when First at 5 continues after the break.